Welcome to the Into the Wilderness podcast. We hope everyone enjoyed the show that we put on 2 weeks ago, the first show of 2017 with a new intro. And to kick the year off, we gave away some Coldwell Emacs ear defenders and we had hundreds of people enter.
Yeah, it was a good start to the year. Yep. Everybody was embracing the competition, which we run every 2 weeks.
Yep.
And we have a winner, randomly selected from all the people who entered. And the winner is?
Lee Young.
Lee Young, congratulations.
So you have 1 month
to collect your,
your prize. And if you don't claim, it'll be just rolled over.
Yep, and someone else will have a chance. So make sure you email us or ping us a message on the various social media platforms. You can email us info@paceproductionsuk.com.
Or podcast@paceproductionsuk.com, which is actually the email for the show, which Byron didn't forgot to mention.
I keep forgetting about that one.
Okay.
We're running a new competition, which is to run, to win a Coldwell XLA bipod. It's a 9 to 13 inch one.
Two or three of these.
Yeah, quite a few of them. Mm. I actually use it on my own rifle as well. So if you want to know how you win this, you need to listen to the end of the show. We will tell you right at the end of this interview how you can win the Coldwell XLA bipod.
Yep.
This week's show I recorded a couple of days ago now, in the heart of one of the glens, just almost at the back of my house. Daryl was away doing some other things, so I was there by myself. But we had two guests. We had David Wright, who is the man behind the camera on Fieldsports Channel, and also the man who reads the news on Fieldsports Channel.
It is a funny show, because I edit all the podcasts, and I wasn't there, and I was laughing.
I could hear you giggling in the office most
of the way through. So it is a very funny show, but interesting as well. Very interesting. And
yeah, because the other guest there is Roy Lupton, who a lot of people know from Fieldsports Channel, but he has the most incredible depth of knowledge, especially when it comes to birds of prey. We kind of dipped into it a little bit. And
we're going to have to get him on again.
We are going to get him on again.
Because we've already said that we're going to do a specific falconry show and dedicate something to birds of prey. So I think Roy is the perfect person to get into
that. Oh, he absolutely is. Because there was two of them there, we had to kind of broaden our discussion a little bit more. But I know that we could talk for a very long time just with Roy and just on that subject. But I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was really good fun. We were sat in this cottage. The fire was going. I'm not sure if you can hear it, but there was a dog squeaking a little bit.
Yeah, he was squeaking most of the way through.
There was a dog in the same room as us, and I think he wanted to be part of the podcast. So yeah, it was fantastic to do. I enjoyed it, and I hope everybody else enjoys listening to it.
Yeah, we've got shows coming up from. We're going to be doing some at Iwa in
start of March.
We're going to be doing various people that we've been trying to get our hands on, but we can get them there, and then we'll be doing more shows at the Northern Shooting Show coming up in a few months' time as well.
Yes, and we've got some really good guests coming up. One, I'm not quite sure exactly when she's going to be on, but Louise Gray, who wrote The Ethical Carnivore, she's coming on the show very soon. So you'll be hearing a podcast from her and all about her book and her the challenges that she faced coming over to the idea of actually killing what you eat, which is something that we talk about a lot.
We're going to be doing a news podcast probably next week or the week after, just because we now have a massive pile of news that
which
we haven't gone through, and people quite enjoy discussing the news and what's been going on, so
they do.
That's what we're gonna do.
It's probably worth also just saying before we kick into the actual interview is that we have just come back from our first wilderness hunt.
Yep.
We had people over from Norway and Sweden, and we went into the depths of the Scottish Highlands, set up our teepee tent, and did what we like to do, which is hunt as raw and real as is possible, pretty much like we do in the Into the Wilderness series, which I'm sure a lot of you have probably watched. And I think everybody thoroughly enjoyed it. And we've got,
it was really good fun.
There's a whole ton of pictures which we're going to start putting out, which you'll see on our
Definitely check out our Instagram page, pace_brothers, because that's where you'll see most of the pictures first before anywhere else. And there are some really cool pictures. And what was really awesome is that we got to be with two people that had never... Well, in fact, none of them had shot red deer before.
No one had shot red deer before.
And some of them had never even shot deer or a big animal before, so it was really magical to be there at the same time.
Yeah, it was. And see their reactions, and also taking stuff back to camp, cutting it, butchering it up, and it was, you know, part of our meals for 3 days.
And the best part is that all the leftover food, what wasn't eaten, was then processed at back at the game dealer once we came back, and being given to the homeless in Aberdeen.
Yes, absolutely, which is a really great initiative from the estate that we were on.
Which they also do with all their pheasants.
Yes, they do.
All the pheasants, none of them get sold, and they all get cut up, sent off, and they're given to the homeless people. Over 1,000 pheasants.
Yeah, which is brilliant. Brilliant to see. We won't hold you up anymore. This podcast, as with all our podcasts, is brought to you by the Scottish Association for Country Sports. They are Scotland and Northern Ireland's largest field sports advocacy body, representing members' interests across the UK, from firearms licensing to wildlife and land management to the broader field sports insurance and legal support. SACS is run by its members for its members. If you are not a member of a shooting or countryside organisation, but you enjoy partaking in it, then I suggest you have a long, hard think about why you're not. And a good place to start is look up SACS and become a member.
Done. Enjoy the show.
David Roy, welcome to the Into the Wilderness podcast. You guys are in my hometown, in my back garden here. For once, I actually found out that you were going to be here, which was nice of Roy to let me know that you were going to be up, David. But yeah, we're sitting in a cottage in a glen, not very far from where I live. You'll probably be able to hear a fire crackling, dog talking in the corner, logs going on fires. So this is very raw and real. You're both here doing some filming for Fieldsports Channel. A lot of our listeners probably know about Fieldsports Channel anyway, because we had your other half, David.
My other wife, yeah.
Charlie on last year. Nobody listened to that podcast. Everybody hated it.
I wouldn't. I didn't.
We were just discussing earlier. It's how many years has it been since Fieldsports Channel started?
We launched on the August 12th, 2009. But we've been sort of building up to that probably about sort of, I don't know, 8 months before that. We didn't know whether anyone would talk to us. So it was... It really was suck it and see. So, you know, we launched ourselves out there on the glorious 12th and just hoped that someone would watch us. So,
Can you remember what your show was on the 12th?
I'm pretty sure it was...
Wasn't the Ferrari one, was it?
No. That was way later. Way later. No, I think it was... Did we do the road calling?
Yeah, we were road... Yeah, it was the first time we went out road calling with John Tobin.
See, that was, again, you know, I was relatively new to this industry, and then... obviously completely new to Mr. Lupton, and he then started talking about road calling, and I had no idea. And then this, I mean, you explained.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, you came to us as a, literally as a field sports virgin, didn't you? So you'd had no experience really in any of the hunting sports or shooting sports. And you'd obviously come from a journalistic background, which, when you first rocked up, we treated you with much suspicion.
He was very nervous. He Googled me a lot, and there's not a lot to see on Google. There really isn't.
Well, we're going to get into your background very soon. Don't worry about that.
You'd have to go that far back. It was a long time ago. I needed the money.
But it's. I mean, by any measure, it's been a tremendous success. I guess highs and lows along the way. But what do you think has been the difference? Because there's a lot of, you know, when you did it, YouTube was kind of in its infancy. And sure, and certainly in terms of hunting films on YouTube, that was in its infancy. A lot have come and disappeared in the years that you've been running. Like, what has been the difference? Why are you still going and still getting more subscribers, still getting more viewers and going from strength to strength, whereas it's some people clearly, it's been a challenge and some haven't succeeded along the way?
I think... a lot to do with a sense of humour and a lot to do with relationships, because we knew that we would be doing probably a lot of similar stuff, and we had to have people in those films that people could relate to, but also brought an awful lot of character, and they could see the relationship and they could imagine going out and spending time with those people. Because when I came into the industry, so to speak, I didn't really, first of all, know whether people would talk to us, and they did talk to us, but also I didn't realise how much information was going to be there. It's all right having the information, but if you can't impart that information, then it's sort of lost. But I managed to discover, through fair means and foul, the likes of Roy, the likes of Crow, who were, first of all, great fun to be around. I was learning something. And I thought, if I'm learning something, then hopefully other people are going to learn something too. So, but they, with that, our relationship developing and my relationship with Charlie developing, you know, you could see that actually this is all about us going out and having a great time. And that's what other people around the world do. That's the link between all the sort of hunters out there. And I think people thought, we have to toe the line of, this is very serious. We're doing this because we have to be ethical. We have to include animal welfare in what we're doing. But people were then sidelining the idea that people actually want to go out and have a good time. And Charlie's always been very, very pro that. You know, he wants to stand up and say, you know, I do this because I love it, not because I want meat for the freezer, although you probably do want meat for the freezer, but it's there inside you and you love doing it. And that's what I saw in the likes of Roy and Crow and Mark Gilchrist and all the sort of guys that were there from the very start, was an absolute passion. But the thing is, what's incredible about Roy is the breadth of his knowledge, from whether it's put an air rifle in his hand or put a golden eagle on his fist. You know, it's extraordinary what he does. It's absolutely extraordinary. And so he's been an absolute gift in the fact that we have gone and covered so many different topics with just one man. It's amazing.
I mean, how was it for you in the early days, Roy? Has that been the first lot of kind of filming you'd done?
We dabbled with some falconry filming before that, with a DVD that we'd made and put that out commercially. But yeah, I mean, for actually presenting to camera and taking it, you know, that little step further and being serious, that really was, you know, my sort of first step into it properly. And as I say, coming from a Fieldsports background, and you know, I spent my life, you know, playing around and shooting and you know, working with the birds and whatever else, and you always build up a fair amount of suspicion from outside journalists, and you know, you do come across them occasionally, and you've got to be very careful, obviously, from a PR perspective, whenever you're dealing
just
with people like that.
That it's twisted out of context.
Exactly, because it's incredibly easy to twist something and to turn it against you. So, you know, when David rocked up and was like, oh, you know, can we do this? Can we do that? Or, you know, what can we do? Is there any chance of coming out and watching what you do? Then, you know, we were all right. Yeah, I was a little bit suspicious, and yeah, you're on guard. You can never trust this man. You've got to be very, very careful what you let him film. But yeah, it will be used as leverage in the future. But no, it's as I say, it's just been fantastic though, because the reception that the Fieldsports Channel has had over the years, and just to see it evolve and develop, has been superb. And again, David was talking about the relationships that we have, and I think that really is the core strength to it, is because we all get on. You know, all the guys know each other, and I think, you know, I mean, obviously, you know, I've only met up with yourself a couple of times now, and but it's clear from the very start, you know, that the people within the industry have got a passion for it, and with that passion, you see it develop, and you see the programs develop, and you see the relationships develop through that, and it really is, you know, a little bit like a family. We do have our tiffs, and we have a falling out here and there, but again, you know, it's that draws us back to it, and it's coming up with ideas and just trying to push the envelope a little bit more, and that's what we find really exciting, you know. And we've made a few faux pas along the way, and you know, pushed the envelope slightly in a direction that probably wasn't advisable, you know, and had a slap on the wrist from it, and then came back in. But yeah, it's part of that learning curve, and that's what I really enjoy. And then to see the response that we get, so to actually get that feedback from people, whether it's through social media, or the thing that I find amazing is, you know, I very rarely go to game fairs now, but you go out, or, you know, you go to a gun shop or whatever else, and immediately people associate with you, and they come over on a very friendly basis. And I think that's, you know, it's quite phenomenal, because you don't realise when it's just David and I in the field, you know, stalking or doing some falconry or bow hunting or whatever else, you don't realise how far reaching it is. And I've had some real odd times, you know, in odd countries.
I thought you were going to say odd people.
Odd people. There's lots of odd people. It's the industry definitely draws on those. But, you know, I've had, you know, guys come up to me in a high street in Dubai. Mm. You know, this crazy Russian guy comes marching up to him, and he was huge, and he's sort of thinking, oh Christ, what's, you know, have I done something wrong here? And he's like, oh yeah, I know you, and you know, and you just have a conversation about it. It just, and I think that's, you know, that's superb. You don't realize how far reaching it is.
I mean, how do you, I mean, clearly you get a huge amount of positive enforcement of what you're doing from people and feedback. But I mean, we were talking about it today when we were just out doing some filming. The odd negative thing that filters in there, and sometimes it can kind of feel like, you know, there's a lot of it. I mean, how did you deal with that in the early days? I guess now you probably just ignore it.
Yeah, exactly. No, I mean, now, unfortunately, there are people that are against what we do. There are people that are uneducated and don't want to be educated into the realms of what we do. And, you know, whenever we're making a film, you try and, or from my perspective, you try and do it in a way that people can glean some information and hopefully, you know, come out after watching it with a positive attitude about what we do. But unfortunately, you know, you're never going to reach everybody like that. And yeah, we do come across antis. We do, you know, we've had our fair amount of death threats over the years and whatever else from.
You're still standing.
Well, yeah, just about wobbling.
Easy target.
And what about you, David? From where you came from, and maybe we should go back there. Let's talk about your filming career behind the camera. From moving from ITV, where you were before, into what you do now, how was that transition?
You're missing out a very important piece before that as well.
Absolutely not. Modeling. Oh, yeah, question. No. I'm going to answer seriously too. So
we'll go back to that, Roy. Don't worry.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. If you start nodding off, please signal to me, sort of wrap up. I'd gone back and retrained I wanted to do broadcast journalism. Mm-hmm. So I went back and I managed very luckily to get a sort of apprenticeship, even though I was quite long in the tooth, apprenticeship with ITV, and went through the ranks there. But it got to the point where I was dodging redundancy all the time because they were losing people before. I think X Factor saved ITV, but before that sort of cash came into that particular business, they were losing people. So they lost all the editors. So I was a journalist. I was a reporter out on the street, you know, cat up tree type thing, or, you know, RTAs, all that sort of stuff. So I was doing that. And then they got rid of the editors, so I had to learn to edit. And then they got rid of all the cameramen with a huge slew of people. So I had to learn then how to use a camera. So I was out, because they said, well, the journalists are going to be out on the job anyway, so suddenly you became a self-contained production unit, which mm-hmm. is incredibly useful. And at that time, I was doing stuff, starting to work with Charlie, and it meant that I had the broadcast understanding, whereas he had the print understanding. And I'd met Charlie doing an ITV production on Wild Boar. So he'd been my expert out in Croatia. With Tomo Svetic, who is still a very good friend of mine. Yeah. So, you know, it was weird that... and also, Dom Holtam was in that film too.
Oh, was he really?
So I've got Holtam, I've got Svetic, and I've got Charlie in that film, all of whom, I should say, are still very good friends of mine. So, you know, that was quite a weird thing, and that was back in 2008. So those skills... I've always been interested in field sports, you know, air rifle as a kid and everything else, but it was talking to Charlie and seeing his enthusiasm for the sport, I thought, you'd be really good in front of camera. Because, that was my business. I wanted people to be expressive and informative in front of camera, and he was doing that. And he was very... I remember him talking about... The thing that got me was that he was talking about boar, and he did this thing about sort of... He sort of almost held up his hands as if there were footsteps. It's like, you hear a boar, it's like... And then you hear roe deer, and it's like more like... And it captured me. Yeah. And I then asked him about the industry. I said, what's going on? He said, well, you've got specialist consumer magazines, you've got DVDs, but as far as the UK is concerned, there is nothing available actually, you know, as far as broadcast media. And then we looked at all the various different options, and YouTube was there. It was very much sort of, oops, I've slipped on a banana skin, but it was an option. We had our own server to start with, and it became so expensive. It's like, I remember, I think we were going to, it might have been going to Ewa for the first time. He said, I think we should go to YouTube. And I was like, really? It looks really bad. It's like, got
it
YouTube
did
branding
early,
all over.
It did in the early days.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I just thought, we said, no, I think it's going to be cheaper, but also I think this is the way to really reach an audience. And yeah, he was absolutely right. We could have done it 6 months earlier, and we always say that maybe we should have done it 6 months earlier to do more land grabbing, because that was, you know, films like The Road Calling that we did with Roy at the very beginning, that has been watched a lot. And if at that
we're
point
talking millions,
yeah, so you know, a number of our films have gone over a million, which is brilliant, and a lot of them contain Roy. He got chance films like George. I was at Bisley Live when George Digweed went and shot, stepped back
from,
and then Peter, so hilarious though. You look at the comments; all the Americans say that we fudged it. He said, "Oh, there's
really?
There people say they're actors. Apparently, they're actors watching George." What a load! I mean, actually, it was Rain. Mark Kahn
just
was
for those people who haven't seen.
George does this thing where he does I think it's like a springing teal target, and he shoots it at 10 yards, and then progressively walks back. So 20 yards, 30 yards, and we got to 130 yards. Mark Kahn from Zeiss was actually had the tent behind us as we walked back. The Zeiss tent was there, and he rangefinded. It was over 130 yards. But people were picking up his shells and looking at the shells and just seeing what he was using. But it was extraordinary. But I think, yeah, he got 130 without any problem at all. I think he might have dropped one shot. But then people were saying on the comments underneath that film, because of the delay between the shot being taken and the applause, mm-hmm. it was clearly dubbed afterwards. I can assure you it wasn't dubbed afterwards. That happened in real time. And George is an incredible shot, and he shot that. And that, you know, that's been watched over a million times.
It was staggering.
It's just one of those moments, you know. It's just one of those moments. And it was a still, bright day, perfect to take those type of... to make that... Well, we sort of claimed it as a world record. You know, crikey, not many people are able to do it anyway. So it is a world achievement, I would say, a world-breaking achievement.
I think we're going to have to touch on it because Roy brought it up.
What?
You retrained. Retrained from what, David?
I was a marine biologist, Byron. I don't know what you're talking about. I have a master's in marine biology, so I have no idea what you're talking about.
Tell the good people of our podcast what your early career was, because we're going to talk about this with Roy. So it's only fair that
I stumbled into a career, which was lots of fun, and I met my wife doing it, which was wonderful. So I was a advertising model for a number of years. And I represented and worked for a number of very, very well-known, famous...
He just swept his hair back, by the way.
he's looking flushed.
I did some good stuff, but I did some appalling stuff. It was always the rubbish stuff that got seen by everybody. I did one particular job for... Apparently, it was a pharmaceutical company. So pharmaceutical company had booked me, and I was there with a girl in a studio, and I was supposed to hug this girl... And she was supposed to be not my girlfriend, but someone who I could tell anything to.
It's like, this right, was your remit, was it?
This is my remit for my modelling job. And so it then transpired that it was a quarter page in the Telegraph for Preparation H. So yeah, there was class moments like that. I did a lot of posters, actually. I was a gondolier. Is that a gondolier? Gondoliero? Gondolier.
Gondolier.
He's the guy that pushes the... gondolas along.
Yeah.
Gondolier.
Yeah.
I was a gondolier for Ginster's Pasties.
Wow. Claim to fame.
Nokia, Marks and Sparks. There's some stuff for Marks and Sparks.
But yeah. You can see it when you do the news there, can't you? You've just got that sort of presence.
Very dashing chap.
there is an inside joke there, right? In the news, it's a throwback.
Well, yeah, I do enjoy news. But yeah, we've never... Again, it's all about... You know, some of the stories are pretty, you know, they are very serious.
Yeah,
but,
there are.
I do it in my back garden. Yeah. And, you know, it's a cheap studio.
Just give us the line. Give us the last line.
For
Come on, you knew I was going to ask for it. Come on, we all want to hear it.
Do I have to turn at the same time?
Yes, please.
Byron, I can't. Roy, you do
you
it.
You can.
No.
Okay,
no,
you do.
Yours. I cannot.
You do the impression.
What's funny? What's funny is that so many people come up to me and get it wrong.
Do they?
Stalking for facts, fishing for accuracy. It's like, no, for God's sake.
So it is?
Stalking for the stories, fishing for facts.
There we are.
Lovely.
Fantastic. Round of applause if there
are any. Yeah. Ripple, ripple, ripple.
Bless you.
Okay, I think we need to give David a break.
Yes, we do.
Roy, people who know of you you know, primarily as a man who is incredibly passionate about field sports, but birds. But your sort of early career, what is the path that's taking you to where you are now?
A misspent youth. No, I was...
As with most of us.
Exactly. Yeah, no, it's the only. I think it's the only way you get into it, isn't it? My passion for birds, I suppose, started first. Well, I got an air rifle when I was seven. An air pistol when I was seven, but immediately had it taken off me because I went out and shot a starling just to get a better look at it. I was Victorian bird watching. So that was, it was a year or two before I got that back. And then when I was 9 years old, I got my first bird of prey. There was a guy that probably shouldn't have been, but he was selling tawny owls at a boot fair. At a boot fair, yeah.
Wow.
He had some young tawnies. And I got hold of one of the chicks, bought it off him, and then reared it up. And that was my sort of first introduction to birds of prey. Then from there you go on and, you know, you learn a little bit more, and maybe you shouldn't have bought it, and you shouldn't have done this, and you shouldn't have done that. And then I went on, when I was 12, I went on some courses with Steve and Emma Ford, who were running out of Stirling Minas there. Who are a lovely couple, and they did, you know, some fantastic falconry courses. And then throughout that period as well, alongside that, I was lucky enough to be sort of taken under the wing of a local gamekeeper who got me into fox calling, who got me into rabbiting, who got me into ferreting, and sort of showed me the way. And it's really gone from there. I blagged it through school and college and what have you, and probably didn't do quite as well as I should have done, but that's because we were bunking off and playing with the birds and playing with the rifles and whatever else. So, you know, it's been something that's been ingrained from a very early age, and it's just something that I, you know, from my very earliest memory is of, you know, being fascinated by wildlife. And I think that it also comes from it's not just the hunting aspect that gets me. It's the understanding and the, you know, trying to learn as much as you can about the subject and about the animals and about the birds and about the environments that you're dealing with. And that's what really sort of interests me and really gets my juices flowing, to try and, you know, try and gain as much knowledge and try and understand as much as you can about the animals that you're dealing with and the environments that you're dealing with.
Hmm. Tell us a little bit about what you've been doing while you've been up here. I know you were up a few weeks ago and you've got a number of birds up. Maybe you can just give me a flavour of the birds that you've brought and the hunting that you've been doing, keeping in mind a lot of people who listen to this might never have seen birds really working, and you truly are working them.
Oh, yeah, no, 100%. I mean, the whole ethos behind falconry originally was to put food on the table. So, you're going out there in an effort, one, to feed and exercise the hawk and to make sure that the hawk is in the best possible condition. And, you know, that's paramount, throughout, and that's the first thing to achieve. Because obviously if the birds are not in condition, or the birds are not a good weight or not fit, then they're not. It's very difficult for them to catch quarry. So they've got to be on the top of their game. We've got to be on the top of our game with giving them the opportunities. But, you know, as I say, we go out there and we're looking to, again, you're not looking for massive bags, but you're looking for to have some wonderful sport, to see nature really in its rawest element. So it is like I suppose, bird watching on speed, because you're just engulfed within it and you are part of it, and you're seeing nature play out in front of you. And that really is, I suppose, the essence of it for me. The byproducts from that are, you know, obviously if you're successful, then you get some, you know, we obviously went out today and yesterday, and we brought some hare home.
We just curried it tonight.
Exactly,
yeah.
We had a lovely, lovely hare curry there, which was superb. It's about using it. It's about making sure that you respect what you catch and that you honour what you catch. But it's, and as I say, primarily it's for watching the birds. We were working two golden eagles today. Cappy, who I think is, I'm not 100% sure, I've got to look back, but I think he might be in his 21st or 22nd season. So I've had him since he was 19, 20 weeks old. And we've been hunting together since then. And I've got my other golden eagle with us, baby. I think he's in his eighth or ninth season. The Fruitail, which is a third season bird. And then we went out this evening quickly with the goshawk to catch a few rabbits. And she's just coming up a year old. So, you know, you've got a big diverse range there. And each one of the birds flies in a slightly different way. And we've trained the two goldies in a slightly different way as well for the way that we hunt them. Cappy is an eagle that we'd let go off into the wind normally, off a wind-facing hill, and then he'll climb above us and wait on. And then we flush the hares with the dogs underneath him. Whereas baby, we fly him primarily out of the hood at the quarry once it's got up. So once the hare's away, then the hood comes off and the eagle starts the pursuit. And it plays out in front of you. But we're working a team of dogs. So we've got, how many dogs have we got up with us? Four, five, six or seven dogs? Can't remember. But we've got a good pack. So we've got our old, well, I say old, she's not that old. We've got a wirehead Vizsla bitch. And then we've got three of her puppies that we're working as well. Four of her puppies that we're working as well. And they've been crossed with a German wirehead pointer. And we tried it as an experiment, and it's working out really well because they're a little bit more biddable than a German. They're not quite as hard-headed, but they've definitely got a better nose than a wirehead Vizsla. So it's a really nice combination. And again, seeing the dogs come through is absolutely lovely, and just seeing them come to the fore and start working. And again, it's the same as when you breed your own birds, when you breed your own dogs, because obviously we've been into it for quite a long time. You know, you see the progression, and it's amazing when you start breeding. You know, breeding lions and breeding for a few years, you definitely see the same traits come out within them. So, you know, the dogs definitely carry the traits of their parents, and again, the same with the birds. You can see particular traits coming out within the birds as well.
Now, that must be incredibly satisfying, and it's quite an unusual thing to have a relationship with an animal over such a period of time. I know when I saw you a few weeks ago, you were telling me how old the eagle was, and I was saying, well, how long's it got left? But quite a lot.
Hopefully,
a lot of years potentially. Mm. How does that relationship change over, 20 years is a long time even to know a person.
Exactly. Yeah. It is. I mean, it is a very, very long-term relationship. And it's, again, I think that's why I wanted to get into eagles primarily in the first place, because it's a bird that you can spend your whole life with, hopefully, or your adult life. So, to see him develop over the years has just been amazing. I mean, all the birds develop over the years, but to see him work with him, has just been an absolute dream. From a child that, the dream of actually being able to work with the golden eagle came to fruition, and then, actually managing to spend that amount of time, working with him has just been, we've been blessed, but hopefully we'll go on for a few more years. I mean, he's same as me, he's got a few aches and pains, and he's developing a bit of arthritis here and there, but yeah, fingers crossed he should be able to keep cracking on.
David, how have you found the challenge of doing something like this? I mean, let's take the example of what we're doing, what you've been doing the last 2 days, filming birds of prey hunting. I mean, it doesn't get much more difficult than that. You can't really, you can't communicate with them like you can a person. If someone is out stalking, you can say, well, hold on a second. You know, to some extent, you've got to be ready. And I guess you've built that up over the years of ever being ready for field sports, which is not something you can always plan for.
No,
how have you found that as someone who didn't necessarily come from a really strong field sports background, as you said yourself earlier?
No, it's every time you go out, you rely on the willingness of the hunters to sort of think about you. And Roy thinks about me. So even though, obviously the eagle is what's flying, it's the person that can, handling that eagle that helps, or handling that rifle or air rifle or whatever. So I need, as much as I want it to be just me being fly on the wall, I need there to be some cooperation with the people I'm with. And what's great about the people that I do work with and enjoy working with is that for one moment, even the heat of the moment, I've got Lupton going, are you on it? Mm-hmm. I've got Crow going, holding back. I mean, Crow lives to shoot pigeons, and yet he will say, are you on it? Are you on it? And you on it? And he'll hold off and hold off and hold off. And then he'll take the shot when he knows I'm on it. So I have very considerate people that I work with that allow me to actually do my side of it. So with the eagles, I love filming eagles. I've always have enjoyed filming the eagles and the goshawks. I think it's spectacular the fact how that someone like Roy can work and manage the eagles like he does. Charlie, for example, loves filming dogs and seeing dogs work. For me, actually, it's more so for the birds and filming the birds. I do love it. And, you know, the slow-mo works so beautifully with them. You know, it just absolutely works a treat. You know, and I've had some really thrilling moments with it. And one of the most exciting sort of flights I got was went mental on Facebook when Charlie reissued it only sort of about 6 months ago. I think we had 12 million views on it, which was the brown hare in Lincolnshire, where, you know, you've got the eagle coming in, the hare escapes the talons of the eagle by leaping at the last minute and spinning three times in the air and just buggering off. You know, it was just extraordinary, wasn't it?
I mean, some of the wildlife spectacles you see are just unbelievable, aren't they? Yeah. And that's part of it, isn't it? Because you know, as I say, it is, you are just, you know, immersed within that time frame and watching nature unfold in front of you.
I think one of the most poignant films from last year, more so obviously for him, but it was filming of the big white fuller buck, which I've been filming for years, but Bex and Roy have been filming for longer. So that was really weird. And Dom as well, who's with us in the cottage as well. You know, we were all there when this magnificent buck was just standing there and then turned broadside. And Roy, I didn't know whether Roy was going to shoot it. Dom didn't know whether Roy was going to shoot it. But there was history. You know, talking about history, obviously, with the golden eagle. There was history with that wild animal, let alone a captive animal.
I don't know the story. I must have missed this one.
It must have been... It was during the rut, wasn't it?
It was in the rut, yeah, it was in the rut.
But it was sort of, it was weird. I watched it again the other day, and it's strange.
It does become personal, doesn't it?
It does become very personal.
What was your story there, Roy, just for those people?
It was a fallow buck on one of the pieces of stalking that we've had, and we knew him as a two-year-old. We got some footage of him coming in to the clattering antlers, we called him in the rut when he was two. And on that particular estate, they prefer the lighter coloured bucks. So although he didn't have the most fantastic head, we decided that, you know, he was one to let go, and you know, hopefully he'd survive. And again, I mean, in the southeast of England, with a wild population of fallow, it's incredibly difficult to manage your bucks, because, you know, the bucks can travel over 20 miles of an evening. And within that range, I mean, you know, most of the stalking grounds down there are sort of 300 or 400 acre patches. So, you know, if those bucks are, you know, walking off, then they're going to pass through a lot of other stalkers' territory. So the chances of them surviving are quite slim. And a lot of the bucks we've left there over the years have never returned. And, you know, you hear tales of them after they've sort of got to 5 or 6 years old, and then, you know, they walk into a neighbouring field and somebody shoots them. So, yeah, that's part and parcel of it. But this particular old boy, he obviously was quite a smart lad and kept his head down. Yeah, each year we sort of went back and revisited that rutting stand and went and said hello and sort of paid our respects to him and tipped our caps and let him walk by. And, you know, we've had some, you know, great encounters with him over the years. But this year, yeah, I think he was, what was he, 9, 10? Yeah, coming on 10. You know, I was looking at him. He'd got an injury to his back leg. Again, it wasn't overly bad, but you sort of start to question. He was definitely going back. You know, his head was, nowhere near as good as it had been. And again, if we'd had a hard winter, you start to wonder, you know, how far the teeth had gone and what have you. So we decided that it was probably the time to take him. And it really was. I mean, I said it on the film, but it was an incredibly bittersweet moment. You know, it was nice to sort of almost draw that chapter to a close, and you've come to the end of it, but it's just an incredibly sad feeling, knowing that you won't see him again, especially when you've had that relationship. Well, you know, we see it as a relationship. I'm sure he thought of it just as a pest that came into the rotting stands.
But what was weird was the face off. He stood there for such a long time looking at you.
Really?
That was weird. That was weird.
Yeah, but it was, you know, as I say, I mean, I decided it was time, whether or not that was the right decision to make. Well, then, you know, it's too late. You can never come back on that. And again, it's just those, you know, those touching moments that you see. And it's just, again, for me to have that captured on video as well, was just a beautiful moment, you know, to see, and just a beautiful film, because it just, you know, obviously we've seen that buck grow, we've seen him grow old, we've seen him go past best, we've seen him at his prime, but you know, as a to have that to go back on and look at in the future of the memories of him, I think is you know, actually quite beautiful.
It's outstanding. And yeah, it's a really hard thing to explain to people who have no real perception of what hunting and who hunters are as people.
Yeah.
Okay, not to say that everybody's like that, but that little story that you've just told there, I think, encapsulates it beautifully. Mm. Because we are so often painted in the greater media as just bloodthirsty killers.
Exactly.
Really. Yeah, okay, you justify it by you eat your stuff, but you like killing. But, you know, there is so much more to that story, and that's a great example, because it's, you know, every year you've consciously made a decision, you've had the rifles in your hands and you've had the choice to pull the trigger or not, and eventually you've taken that decision to do it.
Yeah.
And there is definitely a connection between yourself and the animal.
Oh, 100%. And you know, I think this is something that we try to portray when we're doing the films, that it's not just about going out and killing. You know, it's going out and, you know, bearing witness to the countryside, being involved with wildlife, being involved with the animals that we're dealing with, and showing them, you know, the greatest amount of respect. You know, they are, whether you're hunting rabbits, whether you're hunting hares, whether you're stalking deer, you know, whether you're big game hunting in Africa, you know, you've got to, well, from my perspective, if you don't respect them and if you don't appreciate them, then you really shouldn't be hunting them.
Yeah, totally.
And I think that's something that, as I say, that we try to portray and try to hopefully show people that are not necessarily in our camp that is what we do, and that, you know, that is what we try to do, and that's what we try and impress upon the younger generation coming into the hunting community. And it was something, you know, that was drummed into me as a boy, that, you know, you don't kill anything, you don't take anything's life without showing reverence and understanding, and you know, using that animal to the obviously eating it, using the skins if you can, or whatever else. It's all a part of the process of understanding it, and as I say, showing the respect by not just, you know, it's not just willy-nilly killing it, is, you know, obviously using them for a purpose.
David, how have you found capturing that story? Because I see it done, and I'm sure the rest of the world sees it done so badly, and I don't mean in terms of sort of quality of footage, but grasping that correct storyline that shows the correct emotion at the correct times. I mean, we've all seen the... I almost want to stop myself stereotyping it like this, but it more often than not comes out of America, the sort of stereotypical American...
High fives, sorry.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I thought you were stopping, yes.
Stop. That was a yes. High five, Byron.
Yes, that was a high five. That's what it is.
I wasn't stopping you.
I thought, what have I said wrong?
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah.
I'll sit on my hands for a second.
The high fiving, yes. We see that so often, and it gives a very tainted picture to people looking at it from the outside in. But, you know, you've captured it so well so often because you've, you know, been doing it for so long. You have a weekly show. How has that been for you? And the conscious effort that goes into telling those stories in the right kind of way?
Telling the story is vitally important, and that's what I enjoy. I enjoy telling a story. I'm a journalist at heart, and that's what drives me. And but to be honest, I am hopefully a fly on the wall for a lot of these situations, and what we see is pretty much what we get. You know, I don't say, oh, come on, you can be a bit more enthusiastic about that rabbit, Roy. You know, I don't get, you know, it's, again, I think it's down to the characters that I film, because they're good guys and they love what they do. You know, some of the stuff you see in the States, if you've been standing up on a tree stand for 8 hours with a bow in your hand, and you suddenly you get your whitetail, that, you know, you've put a lot of time and effort into that particular hunt,
and
therefore there's a sense of elation. And, you know, again, emotion is incredibly important, and you know, for a lot of the situations, it's not a life or death situation. We are going to eat tonight, you know what I mean? It's not like it's a case of we've gone out purely to survive, but we've probably invested a lot of time in that. But it's people react normally, and I can't say I've filmed with a vast amount of excitable people. You know, in the situation, there's been a hell of a lot of relief. I mean, we call Roy the postman because we've been out, and it's like this ain't happening. And then suddenly, this roadbook decides that he wants to be famous that evening, and we end up getting a film with an ending, and it's relief more than anything else, I think, rather than celebration.
Hmm. Yeah. And what? Sorry, Roy, do you want to come in there?
No. I was just saying, it's part of it, isn't it? Because it's whenever you're stalking, if you've got people with you, it does make your life a lot more difficult.
It does, doesn't it? You've got to stalk twice.
Exactly. Yeah, that's it. And yeah, David has become a lot better over the years, but initially we had a few words.
Who is it that on the odd occasion forgets hit record? Is it David or Charlie?
I do not forget to hit record.
You do not.
I do not.
But Charlie has.
Charlie forgets to hit record. But as I tell him.
Oh, actually, there's a fox and a deer, one shot after the next. He was with Nick Latus many years ago, is there not? Or do you not even know about this?
The thing is, Charlie doesn't tell me stuff as well because I tell him
now
off.
You found out.
No, but the thing is, what I told him from the very start is what the viewers don't see, they don't miss.
You can't
miss
it.
So he is.
And what you can't see, you won't be upset with it.
That's part of the fun of it, though.
I mean, we turn around a weekly show, so there's a lot of pressure to get something in the can, and sometimes it doesn't work out. And we have, we haven't got 50 people out there getting stories for us. It's us. There's only a little band. There's only me, really, and Charlie, and.
But I think that becomes more of a more of the challenge to actually get the footage, to get something on camera, something that looks good,
something that's interesting.
That's it, and that you're working together. We had this discussion a little while ago, didn't we? Because you got the chance to actually stalk and shoot a deer,
yeah,
and you didn't take it. You didn't really sort of take that much from it, did you?
That was really weird.
Compared to the camera work.
People have asked me about whether I shoot, and to be honest, I don't have the time. There are certain things I'd love to do if I had time. I'd go pigeon shooting, possibly with Andy Crow, possibly not with Andy Crow. I don't know, depending on what mood he's in. And to be honest, I was going to take my first deer with Roy. Maybe but I hadn't shot a deer, but I wanted it to be special, and I had the opportunity when I was up with Neil Rowntree. Mm-hmm. On the Ardmurchan Peninsula, and just before Christmas, and I just thought, this is so beautiful, and I'm with people that are very, very capable, and if I stuff it up, then I'm covered. Mm-hmm. But what was really weird is that I've seen that sight picture so many times now, and I just didn't know what I was going to feel, and I shot this little this calf, and it was fine, job done. Relief was probably my first instinct, but I didn't get that sort of sense of elation that I perhaps hoped for, and I think it's because I was so conditioned to seeing it. I've seen
again
it so
again,
many
again.
Times that I didn't get buck fever. I mean, I've heard people with the radio mic on, and that I can almost hear their heart pumping through because they are that pumped for that moment, and mainly because they don't want to mess it up, I imagine. Buck fever comes from, oh my God, I'm going to pull the trigger. Oh my God, I'm going to take this animal's life. But no, I was sort of almost disappointed that I didn't feel more. But I think maybe it's just because I'd been there, done it, sort of.
Yeah, I
had
but
simulated.
Your hunting is getting it on
camera. But
this
camera,
is it. I
get far more out of a buzz. And what really annoyed me is that I took that shot and there was an opportunity for the stalkers to then go round and do another. This was part of a hind cull. Take another shot around the corner, and the light that was beaming towards him and through the scope and all the issues like that, and it looked amazing, and the smoke that came out of that barrel looked phenomenal, and I didn't have my camera with me, and I was sort of almost more annoyed. I sort of obviously shot the deer, brilliant, that's cool, but then really cheesed off with myself that I didn't have a camera with me because the next shot would have been fantastic, and that frustrated me because my hunting, as Roy says, is making sure that I get the best shot I possibly can. And that's what really drives me. That's my buck fever. The biggest buck fever I ever had was with Bax Hunt when we were doing bow hunting on fallow in Hungary. Bow hunting. We were 20 yards from those bucks and my heart was coming through my chest.
Wow.
That was phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. I'll never forget that. Amazing.
It's funny how the different aspects of it for different people mean different things. And I can very much relate to what you're talking about because I spent most of my life until the last couple of years hunting and hunting loads, you know, all over the world. And I love every aspect of it and embrace every aspect of what that means to me. But recently, I've been doing a lot of more filming. And I have exactly that same thing where, whether it be for pictures or actually for video, if I don't have it with me and I see, just like you said, you know, awesome light shafts coming through the clouds where you could have had someone stalking over this, you know, a little bit of a knoll and a cool rock that's got the kind of shades on it that you just know is going to come out spectacularly on film, and you can't capture that moment. And
you've stuffed your hunting for the rest of your life.
I know. For me, I have that. Yeah, I get when I go back and I can see that it's exactly the same for you, and you realize I got it. I captured that moment. It's almost exactly the same for me because I kind of flip it on its head for me where I came up through the hunting route and began filming. I now get the same satisfaction pulling that off and getting the nice shot as I do from actually hunting it for myself. Mm. And, you know, I kind of feel like I have hunted it myself. I've just been away for a couple of days now with people over from Sweden, and they were experiencing a bit of Scotland the way that we like to hunt it, which is a sort of, you know, as wild as you can. We're camping out there. And I didn't pull the trigger once myself, but I was helping them hunt.
Mm.
And, you know, they were lucky enough to shoot a number of hinds and some roe over the couple of days. I feel like I was hunting for the 3 days. Yeah. It makes no difference to me whatsoever whether I've pulled the trigger or not. But if I've had a part of that hunt, whether it be capturing it like you do, David, or, you know, guiding it, as I'm sure you do loads of times, Roy,
It's part of it, isn't it? It's the essence, isn't it? Of you know, getting there, getting into that position, and again, it's just wonderful to be able to share that, isn't it?
Mm. Sharing it is more important, than anything. Mm.
I think that's what I hope with the channel really is that we've been loud and proud about what hunters do, have told the story in an appropriate way.
And I think that's been a really positive thing because I think, you know, for far too long, people have been hiding, you know, in the darkness and not wanting to be seen, not wanting it to go public about what goes on and what happens. And I think, you know, in this day and age, we've got to be, you know, we've got to be proud of what we do. We've got to be vocal about what we do. And you know, we need to educate people. We can no longer sit back on our backsides and just think that, you know, the threat to our passions, the threat to our sport is going to go away. It's not. We've got to hit it head on, and we've got to come up or show and hopefully prove that what we do is beneficial, you know, to the wildlife that we're dealing with.
Yeah, and no, I think you're absolutely right there, and we've said it before, is that if you look back in time at the amount of effort that went into actually being open about what we do and not hiding it, it was almost reversed.
Exactly.
It was almost a deliberate attention towards making sure that people couldn't see inside. And there was nothing. Okay, undoubtedly there were things that shouldn't have gone on in the past. There are things that go on right now that shouldn't go on. But the vast majority of it hasn't changed very much.
No.
But we weren't open about letting people in. And I think it's damaged us now. It was something that, unfortunately, you know, the generations before us didn't have the foresight to see that potentially in the future this was going to cause a problem where literally it is a misunderstanding or a lack of understanding. And, you know, there's a lot of people who eat meat out there.
Exactly.
And it's very difficult to find a better way to eat meat than what, you know, how we do it.
Yeah. No, 100%. You know, and you can't get better meat than that, can you? You know, the food that we do consume has got to be one of the most healthy ways of eating that you can have. I mean, there's lots of other benefits as well.
More meat.
I wish you gave me more of it.
I can see rolling down.
I mean, crow offers me cabbage whites and stuff when we go pigeon shooting. That's all I get. The odd bumblebee.
All I hear about when you go to Crow is how you clear his freezers out to feed your children.
He has got a haunch for me, apparently, but I don't know what he wants. He obviously wants something. I'm not sure. More air miles is probably what he wants.
I do think you owe him a trip to Argentina.
I think he might be going to Argentina.
Really?
Okay. Yeah. Hopefully you get an invite.
I know.
You must have found yourself eating a lot more game, though, since you've started doing this, have you, David?
Yeah, I love game, and what I love is that my boys love game too. Mm. And if I ever bring anything back from Crow, which, no, he's very good, actually. If we go pigeon shooting, I will have a few to take home. But what did I eat? Yeah, last time I took some game back, there was a mallard and a pheasant, and my youngest wanted to know which had the bigger brain. So he's nine. So he was there, he just wanted to know what was going on. That's so fantastic. He's great. He wants to see the tubes. He wants to see everything.
And which
and
one had
that.
The bigger brain?
Hmm?
Which one had the bigger brain?
I'm glad you asked the question. I think it was the...
Be the duck, will it?
I would have thought so.
Oh, you know what? I can't remember.
Certainly the skull's markedly bigger. Yeah, so yeah. I would think it would be the brain.
I think we're going off on a tangent, boys.
I think we're probably going into something we're none of us know anything about.
This is headshot revisited.
Yeah, don't. Anywho. But anyway, yeah, so the fact that we went to a pub last year and they both had pigeon on the menu. So
that was their choice.
Off the menu. So that was their choice. So that for me is great. And that's the way that they're thinking about their food. So yeah, they love it.
Talking about education and making sure that the right messages go out there. You made a film last year that was actually on the estate that we're on right now, which went out on Fieldsports Channel, which looked at the year in a grouse moor and an estate. I think I phoned you just after that and complimented you on it. It is a fantastic film. The way that the whole thing is put together, and I think the story.
That's because you filmed a bit of it.
We might have mentioned that on the podcast. Well, my brother, I can't even take any credit, but my brother filmed the start of it. But what that film has, I don't know what the effect of it has been. But what that film portrays is the kind of stories that we should have all always been telling. How did you get to putting that film together? Because I mean, it is in my eye, especially in terms of grouse shooting. It is right up there as the one of the most positive points in our sort of recent history from field sports in this country, as a way to tell the correct story in the correct way. I mean, how did it come about?
It came about because. Current owner of the estate wanted to speak positively or show positive things about the moor and what was going on here, and so the best way of doing that was to literally was dip in and dip out to witness some of the work that goes on here. And what worked out very well is that there were some academics here that coincided. I mean, to get 40 plus black grouse lekking, you know, only probably as the crow flies about a mile away from here.
Outstanding.
Was just stunning. You know, it was beautiful. And there was lots of gags about going out early to check out the black cock, but we won't go there. But it was, you know, it was like being in the Amazon jungle, you know, seeing something
as
spectacular as that. Yeah.
Outstanding.
Yeah. And they're flouncing around. But, you know, the academics from Germany going, we just don't see this. We do not see this. And they recorded, I think, 70 different species. They were overwhelmed by the number of, by the biodiversity of this place. But then also the fragility, compared to that, the fragility of the nests, the ground nesting birds, you know, it's not a nest. It's sort of a scraping of a few sort of grass cuttings, you know, and the fact that a dog off the lead, you know, a rambler straying from the path could easily break those nests. You wouldn't have a clue. Wouldn't have a clue that you've destroyed a clutch of eggs. So it meant that I came back during the actual grouse season, and George was here, George Digweed was here. So he is a countryman. He loves and respects what they do up here. And it was the amount of people from the community there as well. You saw this army of people arrive and then this army of people walk across the moor, and coming from a mile away, could see them all spread across. And it was just extraordinary that there's that amount of coordination involved in a day. And no wonder it's so expensive, because the amount of hours that go in the amount of hours in over the year that go into creating something that's as special as a wild bird driven over guns like that. But also the sort of the farm and the pub and everything else is connected to it. You know, this everything's linked there at the top of that pyramid. Is this more
from the outside? It's very isolated. It is the driven day, yeah, and grouse die. Yeah. That's the picture that the outside see if they don't have any understanding of it. Yeah. Obviously, the film that you put together had so many arms and branches.
Their arms, you know, because that element is incredibly exclusive. Mm. It's incredibly expensive, and only very few people on this planet will have enough money or know the right people to be invited on that. But from that, as with a lot of businesses, people benefit from the money that comes in at the top, and it filters down through all the way through the community. And it was trying to be able to show people in a constructive way what happens here and the amount of people that do benefit. And whether it's, I mean, at the time they were doing up a number of the cottages, mm-hmm, local builders, local electricians, local plumbers, you know, there were so many people. It was like it is like all the worker bees are around this hive, you know, and it's sort of...
It's a good analogy, that, yeah.
And it really was... I found it fascinating. And what I do love is when I go somewhere new, somewhere fresh, and I learn. You know, again, I'm a journalist. I want to hear the stories. I want to hear from people. I'm interested in people.
But again, I mean, you know, obviously you hear the negative side from the likes of Mark Avery and Chris Packham and whoever else. You know, and obviously they've got their viewpoints on it, but the you know, I think the negativity that they, you know, they bring to the fore, they just don't understand. They don't see the benefits, do they? They don't see the beneficial side of what goes on here. You know, they're probably not overly concerned with the communities, but you know, just the very fact that without the infrastructure of the grouse shooting, where else would the money come from to support an environment like this? It just wouldn't happen. No. You know, and I think, you know, they wax lyrical about tourism being able to bring in sufficient funding. Mm. But, you know, there is just no way that the money could equal what grouse shooting brings
into the Scottish
government. The
investment to keep this place.
It's colossal.
It's huge. Absolutely.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Roy. You hear that quite a lot. It is something that gets thrown back very frequently about what you could do with tourism if quite often they say, if you just let the land do its thing, you know, just let it be wild.
Exactly.
And yeah, the tourists will come. And we hear that here. You hear it in Africa a lot,
yep,
with trophy hunting. We had Ivan Carter on last year. It was an absolutely brilliant podcast with him. An incredible guy. And he's been doing some incredible things, and the films he's been making have been fantastic. And he himself says, look, there are places where, yes, that is true, but equally there are these vast areas where the tourists aren't going to come.
No, not at
why,
all.
Why are they going to come? And also there, and you can even pull this example back to the UK, if you have people coming to do their photographic tourist bit, how many elephants and lions and leopards and everything do you really need for that?
Exactly.
Well, you don't really need very many.
No.
And so there becomes an incentive to have, well, they are large areas, but relatively speaking to the landmass, very small areas where everybody comes, it's convenient, and what happens to the rest of it? And it's the same is true of up here. What
exactly
would you do with it?
Yeah. No, that's it. I mean, if it went back to what they want, then you would end up with an unmanaged landscape that was really fit for not very much.
No.
I'm sure the rabbits would thrive quite well. But, you know, without, again, it's very tricky, isn't it? Because without the predator control on these estates, without the management on these estates, then you wouldn't see the massive amounts of wildlife that you do. You know, so it's, you know, unfortunately, you just can't have your cake and eat it. There's got to be give and take.
There's always got to be compromise. And
yeah,
as long as we as humans want to live in the landscape that we live in currently, we have to accept that we also have to be part of managing it.
Exactly.
And that's the truth of it. And quite often people, the fact that we have an influence is missed out in the conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
So often. But I think it is, we just, as a community, we need to keep on doing exactly what I think we've seen an increasing amount of. Films like The Year in the Grouse Moor that you made. I mean, what is the feedback been on that?
Brilliant.
Have you heard it's been good?
It's always...
What about, from outside the community? Have you managed to get any feedback from outside the shooting community with it?
Probably my family, but they're probably going to say nice things. I hope they say nice things.
You hope so.
But no, it's that is the issue. It's trying to you know, we're preaching to the converted. It's trying to get the, beyond that. And funny enough, when we do have a film that maybe people get excited about, it goes beyond our community, and that's when people start flagging up and start getting quite abusive about it. But we need to break those boundaries as often as we possibly can. But, you know, it's certain people are never going to listen to the argument. They never will. And, you know, we get those people commenting all the time. You know, we just try and have to beat the drum. And it's like, you know, this is carrying on. These are good people. They're not crazed. They're normal people. They are the bank manager. They are the optician. You know, they are, you know, the Eagle Falconer. But, you know, it's sort of, you know, these are normal people. And they're just going about their passion. And I think is great is that on the likes of Facebook, people are openly talking about what they do, what they love doing. And I think, if anything, I hope with the fact that we've been so proactive on social media for such a long time now, that it's a warm, safe place, and don't worry about actually talking about what you do. You know, it's there's safety in numbers, and more and more people are being quite vocal about the fact that they go hunting and they go shooting and they really love it.
Mm. What do you, is there something that you see in your mind that we could be doing more? I mean, that's a very difficult question, that. But as a community, what could we be doing more? I mean, open question to both of you, to make sure that we can continue the slow momentum that we've got right now to let the outside in. And, you know, ultimately, the reason why we want to do that is to protect what we honestly believe to be the best way to look after the land and the animals that we, you know, we all hunt and manage.
I think it's really just that your circle of friends, to be honest, and whether you're going out for, I mean, you know, when we go out for dinner, or when, you know, dropping, you know, as a parent dropping kids off at school, people know what I do, and you know, or, you know, if they ask my wife, you know, where's David? Oh, he's in Hungary after boar, or this week he's up in Scotland, you know, which is great. I love what I do, and Jane has no issue and loves what I do as well. You know, she's a country girl. But it's going, when we go out to dinner with friends and you have those sort of conversations, and it's either a conversation starter or a serious conversation ender. But most people, you have a chat with them, you explain, and it's pretty rational. I think you start small and just sort of, if everyone is quite happy just to talk about it sensibly and openly, then, you know, then we just spread the word slowly and organically, really.
What about you, Roy?
I don't know. I mean, I think we need to, I mean, obviously we were, you know, there's the subjects that I'm sure we'll cover in a minute, but I think we need to see a little bit more movement, a little bit more dialogue between the some of the government agencies and our shooting organisations as well. I think we need to see, you know, a little bit of a stronger position taken by the likes of Basque and Countryside Alliance with certain issues. And, you know, we talked before about, you know, the issues with raptor persecution and how, you know, how...
Certainly that is a massive taint on... It doesn't really matter what part of field sports you're in. It taints everything, that.
That's it, you know, and I can see, you know, I can see the argument from both sides, because obviously, you know, I'm very passionate about shooting, but I'm also very passionate about birds of prey. Yeah. We breed a lot of birds, and we've done a lot of conservation work with birds of prey. But I think we need to take a sensible attitude to everything. And again, we were just talking about the environment of a grouse moor that has got to be managed, and has got to be managed to a very high degree to allow the species to flourish, to allow ground nesting birds, you know, predominantly grouse, but then obviously all of the wading birds, etc., that benefit as a sideline. But with populations of raptors, there are certain birds that at this moment in time, I think, are self-controlling and don't need managing. And yet there are other species, such as buzzards, which have done incredibly well over the last 20 years all across the country, that are getting to or are currently at a population level where it's not sustainable. And I think we
but there needs to be honest discussions about that.
There does, you know. We need to have discussions. We need to have, you know, people from both sides of the table sit down and have sensible dialogue. And I think that's the only way forward, because, you know, we have got a licensing system in place to allow for buzzard control, to allow for raven control and whatever else. And I think that's something that you know, we need to look at, and we need to sensibly manage it. Exactly the same as, you know, we manage our fox populations and whatever else. The last thing I'd want to see is you know, the last fox shot. But you can't have, if you are trying to manage a population of birds that are vulnerable to predation, you can't have an over predation from from certain predators. And the problem is, you know, because these environments are created, and let's face it, I mean, there's very few places on, you know, on Earth now that are not interfered with or managed by human hand, and certainly nowhere within the British Isles. So because of that, because we then alter the ecosystem, we alter the balance, then we're going to see, you know, different numbers of predators do better in certain areas. And it is, as I say, the buzzard, the overpopulation of buzzards are causing issues.
For other raptors as well?
Not necessarily for other raptors. Well, no, they are. I mean, the you know, they are predating. You know, it's been proven that they do predate on other birds. So, you know, kestrels are being predated upon. Barn owls definitely are predated upon. But, you know, also other game populations, you know, in certain areas, the hare population, the brown hare population is being pushed down because you've got huge amounts of buzzards in certain areas. You know, and again, up here, you can see that if you've got a massive buzzard population, it's going to cause problems when, you know, you've got your grouse hatching and whatever else. So, you know, I think in the future, we need to have sensible discussion and a sensible look at finding a way forward that the estates allow a certain number of birds of prey to thrive, but they have in place a solid management backup that they can go to and apply for a license and get granted it
if there is an issue
and if there is a need, you know. And I think that's something that we definitely need to push forward on,
because I'm sure there must be a situation where land can be managed economically at the same time as for the benefit of all the species to a certain degree.
Yeah. I mean, most definitely. I mean, you know, there's certain species, as I say, of birds that I don't think, you know, need management, and they do need assistance. But let's face it, it's like badgers. You know, why are badgers now afforded such good protection? And it's just because they've had a fantastic PR campaign in the past. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's no different, as I say, to foxes, to weasels, to stoats or anything like that. They will cause an issue.
Mm-hmm. It is still an animal at the end of the day.
Yeah.
I mean, talking of badgers, David, you were filming with Tim in Europe.
Yeah.
Where it was perfectly legal and there was a season to hunt badgers. Yeah. Just for those people who didn't see that bit of filming, just talk me through that and why they were doing it.
They do it because they see them as, well, they have been described as, you know, wildlife vacuum cleaners, and they control them. They have a season which they can control them. They control them with a dog, and you follow the dog, and they have specifically bred dogs to do that, and they bring them to bay. And so I was given the opportunity to go out and sample that type of hunting. It felt weird, I must admit.
And for Tim,
it was weird for us to go there and accompany this guy who does it all the time. And him, you know, and he was taking, just like you would do with a lot of guys, if they take out a fox, they'll pose for photograph with the fox. You know, he was looking at his feed on his Facebook or whatever. They had all been shooting badgers that night. You know, it's just, it was had a very similar vibe to guys who were keen fox shooters in the UK, but that's what they're doing in Sweden, and it's just part of their hunting culture. And this is what I like doing when we go away. Is, you know, people say, "Oh God, you're going to put that film out. That's going to cause a huge reaction." It's like, well, how can you, this is what they do, what I love, experience different hunting culture, down to night vision. You know, in one country it's perfectly legal, another legal, but you can use the lamp, and you know, it's all the same but different. Mm. And you just have to respect how other countries and however hunters hunt. And but I find that fascinating, because you know, the legislation, we're only a few hundred miles between borders, you know, and you see a very different type of style and a very different type of culture. You know, it's just the way they do it in Sweden.
Mm. Yeah, no, it's an interesting one, that, and it's particularly interesting to see how hunters from one culture react to a type of hunting in another culture. One thing that stuck in my mind, actually, from a film series, the Uncharted series that Jim Shockey did, was he was with some, it was a native tribe in a country that I can't, Papua New Guinea, I think it was, and they'd seen this white, like, sloth-looking thing up a tree.
Mm.
And they went to this colossal amount of effort to cut the tree down so that they could club this sloth to death.
Oh, right.
So they could eat it, because it tasted great. What really is the difference? But you could see it, the look on his face, and the guy, Corey Knowlton, who's hunting with him, they were really uncomfortable. Like, it was very uncomfortable for them to stand there and watch this, and yet essentially it is the same thing, and it's a slightly different culture. Although, I mean, in that circumstance, I think the animal probably was a bit stressed while the tree was being chopped down underneath them, but you know, they've grown up with that culture. It is their land, essentially.
Yeah.
Just the same as, I suppose, we would view some things that are done with the Inuits.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sure they do some things up there that we might find a bit uncomfortable to watch, but that's their life. That's how they've grown up. So, I think there definitely does need to be that sort of respect amongst hunting cultures.
But that's what, we try, and, again, it's an element of education. It's broadening people's horizons. This is what people do in Sweden. Who'd have thought? Did you ever know that? The people that, that badgers are getting, this is what I enjoy telling those stories, because it was interesting going out. It was weird, felt wrong, because it's very deep in our culture that you do not do that. And so for us to accompany this guy, it was actually very exciting because you are charging.
Because you were
at night, charging through the wood, hear this dog. He's obviously brought the animal to bay. You know, you are going through, you just don't know where the hell you are. You know, I'm running along with a camera that's IR sensitive, so I got a basic idea. But, you can't really see what you're treading on. When we were going through Clearfell, I was falling on my backside all the time. He's just charging through, trying to get to this animal before it went to ground. And one did go to ground. What was very funny is that Tim offered, I said, I'm not filming down there, because one was brought to ground. And it's like, go on then, Pillbeam. Oh, he jumped. He jumped because this thing didn't have. We left it, we left it be. I think they are allowed to dig. I think they can. Don't quote me on this, but I think you can dig them out. But
I decided not to.
The sport wise, it escaped the dog. It was down. Let's leave it. So,
no, amazing. Is there anything in your mind that you really want to capture on film? That moment, I know you had a bit of a thing with boar for a while.
I had
did you not?
A big thing so with boar.
Well, we'll talk
it's
about this
my
first
nemesis.
Before we look on to the next thing you want to do. The boar story.
No, I just stuffed it up every time. There was just it was the wrong stand. Didn't get a shot. Didn't see any boar. I mean, I used to go out with Dom quite a bit, and
this is over in Europe.
Dom in the UK, because Dom used to shoot a lot of boar in the UK, and it's never being able to see that boar clearly and just get that clean shot. And I've managed now to get a few driven boar. You know, I do find driven hunting incredibly exciting, filming driven hunting incredibly exciting. I was out, last time I did it was with Paul, Paul Childerly in Germany at the end of the year. And that was great. There was some really good shooting. Actually, one of the best moments was Mr. Lupton when he shot his first wild boar in France. And that was a good shot by you. It's a pretty good shot by me as well. So it all came together.
Everything came together. We were very lucky, weren't we?
Yeah, but it was good.
Again, just good. A lovely feeling, wasn't it? Because we'd both been trying for that moment, and then it all came together all at once. Yeah. And it was just a culmination.
But no,
So what is there something? I mean, for so long the boar escaped you, and now you've done it. Now you've captured some great. Is there anything that it is on the list of ticks to achieve? Because, I mean, I remember before you answer that, you must have seen the game change a lot over 7 years in terms of the filming and
filming's
content
changed.
And how you've had to keep pushing
massively.
The boundaries.
Massively. I mean, but, you know, it's fantastic how technology and people are so clever with that technology. I mean, I did budget ratting with Crow, God, I don't know, 5 years ago, when his friend came out.
Is that on the dumpster?
No, that was thermal. I mean, the things that we have available to us that you can now film through. You know, what I'd love is a really good, I'll say strap on, the camera, like a strap
this
on a Skype.
This is explicit now.
something you can, that, you know, can really, really, that doesn't affect the shooter. That
so
you can
just
see film
down the
through the scope. That's really what I need. But I think thermal is going to be very important. But yeah, just the difference of what we started off with and what we're dealing with now, whether it's the IR, whether it's with thermal, whether it's with the drones and all the things that have been made available to us that really, you know, to hire a helicopter would have been 600 quid before it even took off.
Yeah.
But, you know, the stuff that we can do and deliver and the quality of the filming that's out there now, and it's pushing the boundaries all the time. And it's great because, you know, the people want to see their sport represented in a really good way, in a beautiful way. And we do have some beautiful, beautiful films out there representing what we do. And they're inspirational and they're aspirational. And I think sometimes almost we actually almost pull it back a bit and just think about what actually...
Well, do you think it can go too far?
I think so. I think at the moment we're talking to... I think it's great to be aspirational. Of course it is. Mm. But a lot, I'd say 99.9% of the people wouldn't be able to go after an ibex. Mm. You know, I filmed ibex in Kyrgyzstan. One of the best.
That was a great series of films.
But one of the best trips I'll probably ever do. You know, it's just one of those moments and one of the teams of guys that, you know, it just bonded and worked. It was great. It's absolutely brilliant. But very few people get the opportunity to do that. Mm. And I think it's sort of.
People might want to watch it though.
Hmm?
Even if you don't have the opportunity
Absolutely.
To do it, people still want to watch it.
Absolutely. And to be honest, you know, people will get the hunting buzz comes from so many different places, situations. You know, we've done stuff, I don't know, be ratting or whether it's, you know, driven boar, you know, sometimes it just feels you get the same sort of sense of achievement regardless of where you are in the world or what your quarry is. You know, it's that if you've put that time and effort in and it works. But again, for me, again, it's down to the filming. And we've got some footage from this trip, which is extraordinary.
I've had a sneak peek. It is indeed. Yeah.
That's but it is just that evolution with technology, isn't it? It's just, and the evolution of the films when you
but
see.
But also, he's mischievous. You know, we've done some funny films.
He's pointing at Roy, by the way.
I am. Yeah, yeah. I am. You know, we've done some stuff that we've looked at them, played it back and gone, oh my God, what can we do with that? You know, should we play it, not play it? And, you know, we've pushed it. We've pushed the boundaries.
Is there anything you regret putting up?
No.
You don't regret anything that you put
no.
up?
No.
What is the thing that's caused you the most, I'm not going to say stress, but
headshot.
The most, okay, well, there you go. The most reaction,
the
negatively positive, the headshot. And that was with Roy.
That was with Roy. But that was
Roy. You just seem to be the centre of the trouble.
He is. But that
it's cool.
Just explain the reason for putting that film together.
Reason put that film together because we wanted to do a film about head shooting because people do it.
Yep.
And we wanted to show that it's devastating if done properly, but also if you are not 100% sure that you're able to make that shot, do not even consider making that shot.
Because the consequences are
consequences can be yeah. But you know, I went out to do this with Roy because he's been involved with culling park animals and you know, managing deer herds in that way because that's what was demanded of him to do that. And so he has to be on it. So we did a full description of why you're doing it, how you're going to do it, but only do it if you're absolutely certain you can make that shot. And we wanted to just explain it. And I had a slow-mo camera and I filmed that headshot and... it got a lot of interesting reaction because it's very graphic. Mm. We spoke about it for a long time. Charlie and I talked about it a lot. And we decided, okay, we will make the decision. This is going to be 18 only. Only okay. So it's the only film that we've actually put up that we've said we want this to be accessible only by adults. So we did our bit. We felt we did our bit. We felt responsible to our audience, and that's what we did. A lot of people on the continent didn't like it because they don't ever take headshots. Okay. In the UK, we take headshots. Mm. You know, and we felt if people do it,
why not show it?
Why not show it?
This is the part of the honesty that we talked about right
exactly.
like an hour ago.
Yeah,
absolutely. People do it. You know, and if you're going to do it, this is a sort of mess. But
explain it and justify it, which is what
we
exactly
have to.
What
there has to be justification. Yeah. Every time we go out and film, there has to be a justification. We can't go out and go, we knocked something over, yay. That's not what we do. We're doing it either because it's part of a management plan, it's put food on the table, it's an animal that's out of control, it's injured. There has to be a reason. And I think you can tell most hunting stories because there's the backstory. The backstory has to be the front story.
Yeah.
You know, we have to be on the front foot. We're doing this because of X. Because if someone turns around and said, why do you do that? Don't know, just fancy doing it. That doesn't work. That does not work. Doesn't stand up. We have to turn around and say, right, we did this because our mantra is blue skies best practice. And Charlie and I have always had that. So what we do is in the best possible way, and we do it to the best of our ability. And, you know, we want an animal welfare is at the very top of it.
Did you have any kickback from that, Roy, when that was put out, yourself personally?
No, I mean, again, it created an awful lot of interest. You know, the reaction you find, even the reaction from ourselves when you actually sit and watch something like that.
You're absolutely right.
Bearing in mind, it's some, you know, it's something that we do hundreds and hundreds of times, and you look through it, you see it through the scope, but to actually see it
extended in slow motion
in front of your eyes for the first time. To see it in that graphic detail was just quite—it was shocking, you know. And you sort of, you know, David and I both looked at each other like sort of little school kids when we were looking at it in slow motion. Like, you're just like, you're cringing, but you're like, oh God! And can you show that? Should we show that? Mm. You know, and as David said, you've got a responsibility to the audience, but yeah, that. It's what goes on. That is the honesty of what happens.
And a lot of that meat will have gone into the well. All of it will have gone into
exactly.
the chain, right?
You know, and it's, you know, Dom that we're up with it at the moment. You know, he's a deer manager. You know, and we've, you know, that is the shot that we take within parks. That's what we do. Mm-hmm. It is.
And we're being a lot more honest by showing that than the vast majority of other food that goes into the food chain.
Exactly. Oh, 100%. But
non-wild
food. Wouldn't, again, you know, you look at it in its gory detail and in the shocking event of it. But if you look at it, you know, you look at the nuts and bolts of it, I would. If it was, you know, if I was being cold.
I thought that's where this was going.
If my day is coming, I would much rather go like that than, you know, go into a slaughterhouse and go
with
through
all the
process.
Stress and everything.
Exactly. You know, that those animals know absolutely nothing. You know, it is just lights out as quick as that. And no pain, no stress, no fear. They're having a wonderful day and it is literally just
lights out,
done. And that is something that you realise when you see footage like that. You know, okay, it is graphic and it is, you know, it can be described as gory or whatever else, but you know, from the animal's welfare perspective, you can't get better.
I think you maybe have to worry about how many times that's been copied and put up on Imgur or Reddit, whatever, and has been watched many, many millions of times.
Yeah.
It's like, I think we have to question, not our audience, but the general public wanting to watch it.
You know, so I was actually just about to wrap up there, but it's... Since you bring it up, it's an interesting thing that, and it's something that we need to think about within ourselves, is that we see it, if you look at the timeline of a video, the amount of people that rewatch a kill shot, but like, in proportion to the rest, it's loads.
Mm.
It's completely disproportionate with any other part of the film.
Mm.
Why?
I think it is because at the end of the day, humans are a predator, aren't we?
You think so?
We it doesn't. You can't hide the fact that we are a predator. We evolved as a predator, and I think that is the pure essence, you know, of what goes on in people's psyche, that fascination of hunting, that fascination of being part of it, and being engrossed within it, being, you know, being, you know, immersed in it.
It's the end game.
Exactly. You know, and I think that's what draws people to it, isn't it? You know, because it is, because we are, we do live in a society now where we are very sterile,
quite,
I suppose.
Quite sanitized.
Yeah. You know, so I think that's what people look at.
I thought people watched the news. In my shows, there's a definite peak.
You just make snuff films, my
friend. Well, you would know. You'd be able. You
yeah.
Can
well,
tell
yeah,
us.
Yeah. So absolutely, true. Totally true. Forget
people
Charlie
rewinding
Charlie
watching
you.
The news. It's just so they can hear you say what you say at the end.
Yeah, whatever it is.
No, but I mean, you know, before we do go though.
Oh God.
One of the things
what?
That.
What?
What?
No, go on.
No.
David
I
looks
just
worried it,
about regrets of you know, going back to the regrets about things that that we didn't film or things that we, you know, we haven't got for generations to see. The going back a good number of years now, we were out rabbit shooting, and it's.
Oh come on!
No.
For God's
it's sake. Something. It's something that I wished I'd filmed because David hadn't at that time shot a rabbit, so. I said to David, "Do you want to shoot a couple of bunnies?" And he's like, "Yeah." We're just going around getting some ferret food and whatever. So this is one of the, as I say, one of those moments that I wish I'd recorded. But David shot this rabbit, and as part of the process, David got out of the car to go and pick it up. And do you want to explain, or shall I?
No, you crack on. Nothing compared to how he reacted when the rat got anywhere near him, mind you.
I am quite honest that they are the one animal on God's good earth that petrify me. But I would, yeah, if I could run, I would run a mile when I saw the bloody things. But anyway, David went to pick this rabbit up, and I didn't realise quite, you know, how precious David could be, and I think it was the sort of
don't like getting my hands dirty.
Yeah, no, he doesn't like the blood and gore. Anyway, he went to pick this rabbit up, and it obviously had a bit of twitch left in it. And the next thing, you just hear this almighty squeal kick out.
So, almighty squeal. I think he's
that wasn't the rabbit
over egging the rabbit pie there.
Sorry,
over egging the rabbit pie.
But yes, yeah. No, it's one of my favourite memories of a night
I'm
out.
Far
with
better
David.
Now, aren't I?
Sorry,
I'm far better.
No, you are. No, I mean, you know, you've again that evolution, isn't it? You know, you've gone from not being able to pick up a slightly warm rabbit to throwing fallow bucks over your back and carrying them out of woods in Sweden.
King Kong. No.
Huh?
King Kong.
Well, exactly. Are there pictures? Is there evidence of this?
No. Oh no, I did pick it.
Did you take the picture?
Yeah. I'm sure we have got it somewhere. But yeah, no, he's as I say. He's definitely manned up these days.
And on that fantastic note...
Yeah, brilliant.
You're just racking your brains. You're trying to think...
Yeah,
of
there's plenty. We haven't got time.
No, but
time.
Again, yeah, it's just part of the fun of it, isn't it? And it is part of that relationship that we've got within within what we do. And it is just a complete mickey take out of each other all the time. But it is, you know, hopefully at the end of the day, we are getting the message out there and going the right way with it.
Well, this has certainly been a very fun podcast to be part of. And I've managed to keep the fire going. Well, almost. I need to go and put another log on it now. But thanks so much for taking the time out tonight, guys. And
no, lovely
I
to
hope
see you.
That you have a successful rest of your week, because you're very busy the rest of the week, flying more birds.
Exactly. No, we've
and
got
the weather stays good for you.
I know. It has been glorious. So, yeah, fingers
and
crossed it stays that way.
You can tick this off your list of...
About bloody time, Barrow. Tell you, not wrong. It's wrong.
Well, I'll make sure that if we get you or Charlie on ever again, you're first.
Is that it?
What, did you want more?
I was hoping for a bit more than that. No, absolutely. That's very kind of you, Byron. No, it's
You'll
been a
be
pleasure.
First.
It's
You'll
been
be
a pleasure.
First,
it's been a pleasure.
No, thanks very much, guys.
Okay.
Well, that's it for the next 2 weeks. Well, we might join you again with a show in between, but you'll have to wait and see. Thank you to everyone that's been listening the last few months. Don't forget, you can find this on iTunes, YouTube, SoundCloud, Stitcher, on iHeartRadio. And now the list is becoming massive what it's on, so there is no excuse not to listen. You can get it on any device now.
And importantly, share the knowledge of the podcast with a friend. Mm-hmm. It's all about sharing information and learning. So if you know people who listen to podcasts but don't listen to this show, at least tell them to go and check it out and decide for themselves whether they want to carry on.
And leave us a review, please.
Yes.
if you could leave us a review on iTunes, that helps us massively because more people can find us.
We are running another competition this week, and it is to win a Caldwell XLA bipod. It's the 9 to 13 inch, which is actually probably the most useful length that you can have, and it's also tilting and swiveling, which certainly makes it a lot easier when you're trying to angle yourself into an awkward shot without twisting the stock of your rifle. If you want to win this, it is going to be the same competition as we ran 2 weeks ago, and Daryl has the details.
Since it was so popular, we're going to do it again, and we found that simple is the way forward for people entering competitions. So all you have to do is find the post with the Caldwell bipod picture and tag a friend underneath. It'll probably be one of the top posts in the page at the time.
And the Facebook page is Podcast Into the Wilderness.
Mm-hmm. So you can only enter on there. Well, actually, you know what?
You can put the same thing on Instagram.
You know what? You can do the same thing on Instagram. We'll put up a picture. And if you don't have either and you listen to the show, then I'll tell you what, we're kind people. Just email the show and we'll enter you in the competition. Now you're making me do the wrong podcast at Pace Productions UK. And if you could be kind enough to put in the title.
Competition.
And that will help us out. Everybody managed to do it at the 7 days of Christmas. I'm very impressed because
we
had hundreds of emails coming in and everybody managed to put in the correct title.
We will speak to you again in 2 weeks' time. This podcast is brought to you by the Scottish Association for Country Sports.